Hi, I'm Paul Jay. Welcome to the Analysis.News podcast. This is part two of my discussion with Thomas Frank about his book, The People. No, I got to get the inflection right on that to get the proper ridicule dripping off the lips of the liberal
elite. Can I give it a shot, Paul? So my daughter and I were actually working when I did the audio book of this. We were working on how to say the title, and here's what I finally came up with: The People. No. No.
At any rate, once again, joining me is Thomas Frank, who has just told us how to say the title of the book. And I assume everybody knows, but just in case, Thomas Frank is the author of many books, most notably What's the Matter with Kansas? And he's in Kansas as we speak, and Listen Liberal. And his most recent book, he just told us how to say, The People Know. And I refuse to whine the way he just did. Even if it captures the full meaning of the title. All right, so we left off part one. As we head into the 1920s, the populist movement has more or less fizzled out. It's kind of split. Some of the movement is kind of assimilated into the Democratic Party. Some have gone into various socialist parties. The 1920s is a period where everyone's optimistic. Capitalism seems to be just honky-dory. Lots of people are buying into the stock market and borrowing, and there's the promise of wealth for everybody. And then along comes the great crash in 1929, and we won't get into exactly why all that happened, but not the least of which is the amount of speculation and leveraging, borrowing money to buy stocks and other issues. And then we head into the Great Depression. So this now starts the beginning of may not have been called the next version of the populist movement, but in substance, it's very similar. So talk about the development of the movement in the 30s, and how influenced is what was the populist movement coming out of areas like Kansas with the kind of socialist and communist movement that's developing in some of the cities, influenced by Marx and socialist movements all over the world. I guess they're separate strains, but they're certainly very related too.
Yeah. So to take a step back, a lot of populists, when the People's Party fell apart after the 1896 election, a lot of them went into the Socialist Party. And in fact, Kansas had a big socialist contingent, and so did Oklahoma. Oklahoma was, I believe, had the most socialists per capita of any state, which is hard to believe. You know, Trump won every single county there. But
makes you think of West Virginia used to be something like
exactly
that.
same story there. But in the 1930s, it was the word populist was not used to describe the left-wing movements of the day, but it's appropriate because in my mind they come out of the same tradition, that the populist tradition sort of Franklin Roosevelt talks like the populists used to, has a lot of ideas like they used to. And even more sort of important is the labor movement. So the populists had reached out to organized labor in the 1890s. Some unions signed up with them, but by and large, their leadership did not, because they didn't believe in working. They didn't believe in having a political party. And, they thought they should work through the two main parties or something like that. And by the 1930s, labor is very different. It's really radical. They are, it's exploding in size. Let's put it that way. People are signing up for unions all over America, and organized labor becomes the great force of the decade, the great social movement. So every bit as big and as powerful and as strong as the farmers, the radical farmer movement had been in the 1890s. And there were also radical farmers in the 30s. There were a bunch of, like the In Minnesota, you had this thing called the Farmer Labor Party. They still exist today. Now they've been folded into the Democratic Party now, but this was their heyday. They elected a very radical governor of Minnesota. There were similar politicians in all sorts of different parts of America. But basically, this sort of populist dream of bringing together all these different working class people, it succeeds in the 1930s, and you have a very radical decade. And there's the culture of the decade is extremely populist. I'm thinking of the WPA murals, the Hollywood movies, even made by people like Frank Capra. All of them were, and we mentioned Carl Sandburg in the last episode, all of them were the sort of the great theme of the art of the 1930s was the nobility of the common man, you know, the people. And it went along with the left wing politics of the period. And so you finally did have a regulatory state, and you finally had, workers were able to organize, and the government started, the income tax began in earnest. And there was deficit spending, and the government set up relief programs. They hired people to do public works. It was an amazing time of great ferment. And as we mentioned at the very start of the show, Paul, the book is a history of different sort of populist chapters in American life, but it's more importantly, it's a history of anti-populism, of how people opposed the populist tradition. That's much more interesting to me. And what you see in the 30s is in 1932, when Roosevelt was first elected, people really didn't know what to expect. They didn't know what kind of president he would be. His platform looked pretty conventional. He did talk big about the New Deal, but nobody knew what he meant by that. By 1936, however, they did know, and they knew what it consisted of, and it was regulating banks, regulating big business, all the things that I just mentioned. And you had this what I call a democracy scare, when the members of the elite in America come together in this kind of ironclad consensus against what they regard as the worst elements of society, who are trying to take power and sort of inflict taxation and regulation on their betters. And they talked this way very openly. And the groups I'm referring to in the 1930s, it's very similar to 1896. So it's newspaper publishers, of course, the Republican Party, of course, and then this sort of union of business interests that was called the American Liberty League. It's the sort of great first of the great right-wing front groups. And they raised an extraordinary amount of money, more than a political party, more than the Republican Party, and spent it to bring Roosevelt down. And, went on this, just like 1896, went on the warpath against him in this incredible way. And I, again, have a lot of fun in the book quoting and, giving illustrations of what their war on Roosevelt looked like. It's very funny. It sort of turns. There's a reason historians don't write about this stuff. Revolting. There's a lot of scientific racism, bound up in the war on Roosevelt. Because, as I said, it's a democracy scare. So it's not just that they're angry at Roosevelt; they perceive the sort of deplorables are coming to get them, and they've got it's the whole sort of bottom half of society is trying to get above its station, is trying to order its betters around.
Well, there's a section of the U.S. elites that are very pro-Hitler, starting, of course, with Henry Ford, who's a sort of well-known one. It was given the equivalent of the Iron Cross by Hitler.
Wait, isn't that a Lindbergh?
No, Henry Ford. Ford used to send Hitler, I think it was $500,000 every year on his birthday.
Oh, my God.
And Hitler actually credited Ford with inspiring his anti-Semitism and opening his eyes to the threat of the Jews.
Really?
Hitler was a big fan of Ford and vice versa.
Huh. So I was surprised at how much fascism there was in the United States in the 30s. William Randolph Hearst ran newspaper columns by Goering. I didn't know that. There were all sorts of little local fascist groups that were set up. up to break strikes, that sort of thing.
Well, General Motors was arming Hitler. When Hitler invaded Poland, he's doing it in vehicles made by GM.
What really got me, Paul, is reading through the sort of barrage of hate directed at Roosevelt. And it's almost exactly analogous to what they did to William Jennings Bryan in 1896. And I was reading through it. The internet is such a wonderful thing, Paul. You can do this research without, you don't really have to go to the archives anymore or to the library. I mean, you have to go a couple times, right? But you don't have to spend every waking hour there anymore. You can do so much of it over the internet. And I was able to read, all of these pamphlets issued by the American Liberty League, many of which were transcriptions of radio speeches. And the red baiting of Roosevelt is just incredible. And as I mentioned before, the eugenics, I was so surprised at how many times these antagonists of the New Deal, and these are prestigious men, these are leading economists, leading lawyers, leading captains of industry, came back to eugenics as a way of describing what they were trying to say, which is that the ruling class rules because they are better people.
So FDR does not try to have quote unquote bipartisan politics because of this populist support. He fights his enemies. He does not try to compromise with these other sections of the elites, which is kind of in itself fascinating. And then he picks,
they do offer the olive branch to him very early on. The elites say, go back on the gold standard, stop encouraging workers to organize. This is what the National Association of Manufacturers, one of the big corporate sort of front group, said this to him, and he and his associates basically laughed it off. They're like, no way are we doing that. And so then the war was on. Yes, and he did not compromise. This is one of the most extraordinary things about Roosevelt. He fought them very forthrightly and was real upfront about it, gave prime time radio speeches about what he saw happening. We have taken the power away from this country's dynastic rulers, and they want their power back. And he said this to the American people, and it rang true. I mean, they could see that was the case in their own lives.
And he advocated something that, frankly, even Bernie Sanders didn't advocate, although I'm sure he supports. But Roosevelt advocated public ownership. He talked about the electrical utilities.
Yes.
And if they can't service the population with effective and reasonably priced electricity, then they should be taken over and turned into publicly owned utilities. And you can extend that principle.
Yes, he did say that. And that's the famous, what's the law called? PUHCA. I'm trying to remember what it stands for. It finally got repealed, or most of it got repealed in one of the big deregulatory measures of, a couple decades ago.
You once said something to me in one of the interviews we did earlier, that the liberal elites that run the Democratic Party, the aristocracy of the Democratic Party, it's not that they don't like the left of the party, the Bernie Sanders and such. They hate it, you said. I'm quoting you.
Yeah, they just despise them. Yeah,
and I think it's really interesting that they idealize or idolize FDR, but they despise the actual policies he advocated and the people that supported him.
That is exactly right. They like him because he was a winner, and look, he is the reason you have a Democratic Party today. It all goes back to Franklin Roosevelt. So they admire him because he did, he was the guy was a master politician. I was reading one of the biographies of him, and they said you could take a map of America and draw a line across it, and Roosevelt, every county that the line went through, Roosevelt could tell you who it voted for, who was in charge in that county, what the issues were that the people there cared about, et cetera, et cetera. He was an excellent, preternaturally good politician. And yeah, if it wasn't for him, the Democratic Party would not really exist today. So they have to admire him. But yeah, you're exactly right. They they hate and despise the kind of people that supported him and that made up his administration and that, you know, were doing things in the 1930s. It made this country a middle class. You know, Paul, we keep all my conversations with you. We come back to the ironies of American history that the success of the New Deal gives you in turn the great middle class. You know, suddenly blue collar workers are paid, not suddenly, but over, you know, give the New Deal a couple decades to work. And by the 1960s, blue collar workers are being paid, you know, they're middle class citizens and they have a house in the suburbs and they have two cars and et cetera, et cetera. And, they become, a lot of them become Republicans. So, I'm sorry. That's too much. I bit off too much there. That's I want to go back to the 30s. I want to stick with Roosevelt. So the campaign against him is shocking, but it involves the same kind of ironclad consensus of elites that you saw in the 1890s. And I think the best illustration of this is one I just found by chance. I was reading, of all things, Thomas Hart Benton's memoirs. Benton was from Kansas City, and I finally got around to reading his memoirs. I meant to read it for many years, but he used to just drive around the state of Missouri, just meeting people, you know, taking pictures of them, you know, painting them. And that summer he describes, you know, driving around, meeting people. And he's in the home of a banker somewhere, a retired banker, a man of standing. And the banker, Benton, apparently makes the grave faux pas of saying something nice about the New Deal, you know, and the banker just erupts and, you know, and talks about how they're going, you know, that we're going to put your class back in their place and we have the machine guns and this kind of thing. This is the most extraordinary outburst. But that was the feeling on the ground, this hatred of Roosevelt. The newspapers of this country absolutely despised the man. And I take a whole lot of illustrations of this from the Chicago Tribune, which is legendary for their anti-Roosevelt invective. They would put every day on the front page, there would be a little notice at the bottom. This is in 1936, leading up to the election. It would say, you have X number of days in which to save your country, you know, however many days it was, counting down to the election. And they did this every day. And you can look it all up. It's all easy to find online now. Go back and read your Chicago Tribunes. And they would run an editorial every day under the headline, "Throw the Rascals Out," you know, denouncing Roosevelt as a communist, denouncing him as, you know, it's class war. These people are incompetent. These people are paranoid. These people are mentally ill. I mean, they, meaning the New Dealers. You know, this is the worst elements of society trying to lord it over their rightful masters. This is the world turned upside down. That's how they greeted the New Deal. And then, of course, he won in one of the greatest landslides of all time. Roosevelt totally prevailed. So they were able to defeat William Jennings Bryan with this strategy, but Roosevelt beat them. He had the radio. He had, you know, his support among the people. They could see that he wasn't really, you know, his support was very strong. They could see he wasn't really a communist. He wasn't really crazy. He wasn't a dictator. You know, he wasn't an authoritarian. They could see that, and they could hear his voice on the radio, and he won in this overwhelming landslide. Where was I going with all this? The thing is that it was another democracy scare. So this is a pattern, Paul, that recurs throughout American history, 1896, then again in 1936. And it always consists of the same thing. So the press comes together, unanimity. You have this coming together of academics. There are all of these sort of, you know, whatever statements signed by a whole bunch of economists, something that you see again in our own time. But orthodoxy is the key. Orthodoxy came together against Roosevelt and his experimentation, and this whole idea of a you know, the unfit members of society rising up against their betters.
So we head into World War II, and I'm going to just jump through so many things that one should talk about if you're digging into this.
But that's what the book does. The whole idea is to do this episodically because you can't do the whole history, right?
Well, I want to hit something that maybe isn't as touched into the book, but I think we need to talk about. Roosevelt's vice president at this by this point is Henry Wallace, and it's actually really of mainstream politicians the really embodiment of these kind of progressive populist socialist ideals, is certainly as socialistic as you'd get it in a vice president.
Yeah, and from Iowa, from this sort of radical farmer. Actually, he didn't think of himself as a radical, but what he was from this sort of farmer background, farmer labor background.
And the policy he came to in the end was as radical as anything you could find in that kind of politics. But at the Democratic Convention, I guess it's in 1945.
44, yeah. They toss him overboard. Yeah.
Yeah. They dump Wallace. Truman becomes president. Truman drops atomic weapons on Japan and is goes along with ushering in the House of Un-American Activities Committee, McCarthyism, which attacks anything that's certainly anything communist, socialist, but even anything populist, anything that even smells slightly of a kind of left populism, gets viciously attacked and you know, practically drives it underground in the 1950s.
Yeah.
And that becomes who the Democratic Party is for quite some time.
Yeah, but I would go easier on Truman than that. It is true that he sort of unleashed the McCarthyism, but I don't think, I mean, he clearly thought it was out of hand when McCarthy got going. You know, McCarthy called him a communist, you know.
Yeah, well, not just the McCarthyism, because there's no bigger democracy scare than the Cold War.
Yeah. Well, that's another, you know, great moment of hysteria. I feel often, I'm getting way ahead of myself here, but I feel often like we're living through some version of that again today, you know, but we'll talk about that later. Truman did use, what they did to Henry Wallace is one of the heroes of the book. So Henry Wallace also was a great user of populist language. He wrote a book even called The Century of the Common Man. And it was supposed to be his reply, his pushback to when the Time magazine said that this is the American century. He said, no, this is the century of the common man. That kind of language was very common in the New Deal days, and especially during the World War II iteration of the New Deal, when they were, you know, trying to persuade the rest of the world that we were not just fighting to rescue the British Empire, which is what we turned out to do. Truman was clearly less radical than Wallace, but he did do a couple of really wonderful things. And one of them, I mean, they didn't get anywhere, but he's the one that proposed universal health care for America and really fought for it and was beaten on this. I mean, this is by within, you know, 2 years of the end of World War II, the right is pushing back in exactly the way that you just described. And, you know, his universal health care never gets anywhere. But we've never got it in this country. And damn, it would be nice if we had it now. I keep thinking about that as we go through this epidemic.
See, the way I see it is, you know, from Truman, and then you get into when Kennedy, the party gives up this kind of real policies, to some extent rhetorical, but actual policies of Roosevelt, of taking on concentration of wealth, taking on the big banks, taking on there's a fascinating quote from Roosevelt where he says this merging of corporate interest and the government and the state is the definition of fascism. And it's one of Roosevelt's speeches. The Democratic Party turns its back on all of that after World War II.
Yes.
And becomes, with Kennedy, the party of the greatest expenditure on the military-industrial complex ever. It starts with Truman. And Ellsberg has an interesting quote, Daniel Ellsberg, Pentagon Papers. He says the Cold War was essentially a commercial subsidy for the aerospace industry.
Yeah.
They needed an excuse to spend all this money on bullshit.
That's pretty cynical, but it's hard to avoid that conclusion when you live in nowadays, when you live in Washington, D.C. And one of my friends was describing this the other day, and he said, basically, you know, we fight these wars just as a way of subsidizing these companies. You know, that's what it exists. That's what we have the army for. It's just a subsidy racket for these private companies.
The whole SAGE radar system, the thing, the big board, like in Dr. Strangelove, a total fraud, never worked for a day, over $1 trillion over 25 years, goes on and on, where the whole military industrial complex fundamentally driven by commercial interest, with the excuse being the Cold War. But the reason I'm going there is because the Democratic Party, at least an important part of it, and the part that still continues to control the machinery of it, is very much that party, and which includes the Vietnam War. And it's that section of the Democratic Party that so despises what they call populism.
So I talk a lot in the book about populist culture of the 1930s. And one of the sort of great expressions of that period was this movie, Citizen Kane, which I'm sure you've seen, and I have myself seen many times. But while I was writing the book, I finally got to see it in high definition on one of these modern TV sets, and I was really struck by it because it's on the one hand very populist, as all the stuff from that period is, but it's also the story of a demagogue. And the sort of left culture of the 1930s was very, very, very concerned with the problem of the demagogue. But the fascinating point is that they could draw a bright line between the demagogue and between the demagogue and between legitimate populism. So Kane is the great demagogue, and he's appealing to people based he's like talking about the underprivileged and the underfed and all this, and it's all bullshit, and everyone can see that. And the other characters in the movie sort of remind him of how full of shit he is. Here's the thing that I want that people don't remember. That's Donald Trump's favorite movie.
Okay.
Only he totally misunderstands it. He thinks the demagogue character in the movie, Kane, right? Citizen Kane, is the hero.
He's a good guy.
He doesn't get it. So there's this moment where Kane is running for governor of New York, and he's speaking in Madison Square Garden, and he's giving this kind of Trumpian speech. And there's this huge picture of his own face behind him with his name in gigantic letters. And it's like, that's what they did at the Republican convention in 2016. Remember Trump's name in huge letters? Trump puts his name on everything. And one of the promises that Kane makes in this speech, do you remember this? Is to lock up his rival. He's going to throw his rival in prison. Lock him up. And I was watching this and I'm like, oh my God, I suddenly, get where Trump, came up with all this crap. But there's this scene where that I never noticed until I saw it on a high definition TV. And Kane is talking to his wife or something. There's a close up on his face. He's wearing a fancy tie with a stick pin in it. And the stick pin is the letter K, great big gold K. That's Trump. They're both these incredible. It's everything about Trump. These incredible narcissists, It's a demagogue based on William Randolph Hearst, as imagined by Orson Welles. And this is Trump's hero. Isn't that amazing?
Okay, well, I'm jumping too, but I've been wanting to ask you this, so now as good a time as any. Why does that type of narcissist, at least nowadays, appeal to so many rural and some working class urban, but more rural people? A complete, utter narcissistic character, so obvious to see. And he's not the only one that appeals to people like that. Why?
Oh my God, Paul, that should be the subject of my next book, but so many people have tried to understand that. A lot of it is, I would put much more emphasis. So we're putting aside, you know, the possible legitimate reasons people might have had for voting for Trump, which you and I have talked about at great length.
Yeah, and there are some, obviously.
Yeah, there are. And we're also putting aside the sort of scapegoating reasons, the sort of racist reasons that people might have voted for him. And you're talking about something else, which I think is bound up in our mass culture in this country and in the sort of the logic of TV, the logic of specifically of reality TV, which has taken over television entertainment. And people think there's something normal about that. They think there's something maybe even admirable about that. By the way, I would include I think the left has gone down this path to a certain degree also. And we'll talk about this, I hope, later on. What I call the utopia of scolding. I can't understand the logic of it because it's not how you build a political movement.
Well, let's hang on to that because I think that's really important. And we're going to do that in the next segment. But I want to go at this a little more because it's not just the political figure like Trump. Like I've always found it fascinating. I can't quite understand a culture which, at least until very recently, was very homophobic. Loved Liberace. I mean, the gayest guy you could find. I mean, and even somebody as narcissistic as like Elvis Presley. He's not some. I don't know the kind of gold and stuff he wore. I mean, there's a reason why you go into transvestite and other kinds of clubs where people portray different characters, and they love to portray Elvis Presley because the flamboyancy. How does that appeal to conservative rural Americans?
The same people who loved Woody Guthrie.
Used to, and, before that.
And the Joads, you know, we're the people we keep on a coming. Paul, I don't know the answer to that. And even if I did, I couldn't do it in 1 minute. So,
all right.
That's next book, man.
All right, we'll park that one. Okay, that's the end of part two. We're going to do a part three with Thomas. Please join us for that on the analysis.news podcast.